Well friends, now we'll begin with various malignancies that occur in oropharyngeal region. So this is forming a very important part of malignancies arising upper aerodigestive tract. So first we'll see epidemiology. So principal etiological factors are tobacco and alcohol. In Europe and North America, this is mainly through the cigarette smoking combined with alcohol abuse. But synergism between alcohol abuse and tobacco leads to development of squamous cell carcinoma in the head and neck. It is well established. So whenever you have got two etiological agents which are occurring in the same patient, they may multiply the effect of carcinogens. So what are the risk factors associated with cancers of the head and neck? So these are tobacco, alcohol, areca nut or pan masala, human papilloma virus, Epstein-Barr virus, Plummer-Vinson syndrome and poor nutrition. So all these factors should be kept in mind, because you may be asked question, which of the following etiological agents may be associated or may not be associated with malignancies of head and neck. So oral malignancies are mainly associated with all these etiological factors. So tobacco is the most common. In Indian scenario, the use of pan, that is combination of betel nut, areca nut, lime and tobacco, along with reverse smoking, which is called as chutta smoking. So it is smoking with cheroot with the burning end inside the mouth. These are responsible for higher incidence of oropharyngeal cancer. Betel quid appears to be a major carcinogen, although there is also a relationship between slack lime and areca nut and cancer. So all these etiological agents should be kept in mind. So now we'll see malignancies arising from lip and oral cavity. So the oral cavity, the anatomically, it will extend from skin, that is vermilion border of lips, anteriorly to the junction of soft palate superiorly to the line of circumvallant papillae on the junction of posterior 1/3 and anterior 2/3 of the tongue posteriorly. So the region of lip and oral cavity should be kept in mind. So this definition is very important. The anatomical sites that are frequently involved in mouth cancer, they include floor of the mouth, lateral border of the anterior tongue and retromolar trigon. So retromolar trigon is an area posterior to the last molar teeth. So what is the pathology? The course of the nerves, perineural invasion, blood vessel, lymphatic planes and facial planes influence the spread of the disease. So you may be asked question, which of the following structures, these are important in spread of the disease? So these are course of nerve, perineural invasion. So perineural invasion along with the alongside the nerve, blood vessel, lymphatic pathways and facial planes, these are very important, which will influence the spread of the tumor. Facial planes, including periosteum, they serve as barrier to the direct spread of the tumor, but they will contribute to the spread of the tumor into cervical lymph node. So they have good lymphatics and along with them the lymph node metastasis can occur. Angioinvasion is also carrying a negative prognosis and it will correlate directly with the distant metastasis, particularly in the tongue has got more blood supply, and many a times angioinvasion, if there, it has got direct metastasis to other part of the body. Histologically, squamous cell carcinoma is the predominant histology for tumors arising in oral cavity and oral pharynx. Lymphomas, particularly in Walder ring, so Walder ring will consist of tonsil, tongue base, lingual tonsil region and posterior 1/3 of the tongue. These are very important. So squamous cell carcinoma and lymphoma, these are two tumors which will occur in oropharyngeal region. So lymphoma Walder ring should be kept in mind. So you may be asked question, the components of Walder ring. Now we'll see various conditions and various lesions that occur as pre-malignant condition in upper airway malignancies. These are erythroplakia. So erythroplakia, speckled erythroplakia and chronic hyperplastic candidiasis. So these are high risk lesions. So they have more chances of developing in malignancy. So these are called as pre-malignant lesions. So erythroplakia, speckled erythroplakia and chronic hyperplastic candidiasis. Now we have got medium risk regions. So these are oral submucous fibrosis, syphilitic glossitis, pseudorufenic dysphagia, which is also called as Patterson-Kelly syndrome. So these have got medium risk lesions. Next we have got low risk or equivocal risk lesions. So these are oral lichen planus, discoid lupus erythematosus and discoid keratosis congenita. So these three lesions have got low risk or equivocal risk. So various these lesions should be kept in mind because they may be asked question. So premalignant lesions of the oral mucosa and oropharyngeal mucosa, they present either leukoplakia, speckled leukoplakia and erythroplakia or erythroplasia. So now we'll see these lesions in detail. Leukoplakia is defined as any white patch or plaque that cannot be characterized clinically or pathologically. So it may not be any other specific lesion. So non-specific redness or whiteness is labeled as a specific premalignant lesion. So when it is white, it is called as leukoplakia. It is purely a descriptive term with no histological correlation. Now we'll see speckled leukoplakia. So this is a variation of leukoplakia arising an erythematous base. So when they are have erythematous base, it is called as speckled leukoplakia. So it has got the highest rate of malignant transformation. So if you are asked question, which of the following lesions has got highest rate of malignant transformation in oral cavity? You may have leukoplakia or speckled leukoplakia to confuse you, but it is a speckled leukoplakia which has got highest rate of malignant transformation. Now we have got erythroplakia. So it is defined as a lesion of oral mucosa that presents as a bright red plaque which cannot be characterized clinically or pathologically as any other recognizable condition. So this is very important definition. So now we'll see various theoretical assumptions for formation of synchronous and metachronous lesions in the oral cavity. The diffuse and chronic exposure of mucosa of upper aerodigestive tract to carcinogenic substances. So various carcinogenic substances like tobacco and alcohol, they will cause widespread adverse changes in mucosal epithelium. So the consequence of diffuse exposure is the development of separate tumors at separate anatomical sites. So when you have got wide exposure of these carcinogens at throughout the mucosa of oral cavity or pharynx, they will have all regions, so all field will be having more prone for having carcinogenicity. So these may present simultaneously within 6 months. So they are when occur within 6 months, they are called as synchronous lesions, or when they have got delayed presentation of more than 6 months, it is called as metachronous. So if you are given a clinical scenario having two cancer lesions occurring within a span of 6 months, these are called as synchronous lesions. So this definition should be kept in mind. So separate primary tumors that may not represent distinct genetical mutations, but rather the same clonal origin of cells which migrate to separate sites in upper aerodigestive tract. So this synchronous occurrence of tumors may not be a genetic predisposition, but it is the same migration of clonal mutation cells leading to the formation of cancer at two different sites at the same time. So we have seen pre-malignant lesions. Now we'll see pre-malignant conditions. So these are chronic hyperplastic candidiasis. So chronic hyperplastic candidiasis produces dense plaques of leukoplakia, particularly around the commissures of the mouth. So most common site for occurrence of chronic hyperplastic candidiasis is commissures of the mouth. So this should be kept in mind. These lesions have high incidence of malignant transformation, thought to be result of invasion of lesion by Candida albicans. So whenever they get infected secondary by Candida albicans, they will have more chances of getting in malignancy. The treatment, the specific management of chronic hyperplastic candidiasis, which include a prolonged, that is 6 weeks, topical antifungal treatment or systemic antifungal treatment, which is 2 weeks. If the lesion persists after medical therapy, surgical excision or laser vaporization should be done. So whenever you have got recurrence, or if the patient doesn't respond to this oral, topical or systemic antifungal therapy, they may require excision. Next, pre-malignant condition is submucous fibrosis. So oral submucous fibrosis is a progressive disease in which fibrous bands form beneath oral mucosa. The scarring will produce contracture, resulting in limited mouth opening and restricted tongue movement. Tobacco smoking alone is not associated with oral submucous fibrosis. So all these sentences should be kept in mind, because they may be asked as a MCQ, and you have to, which of the following is true or all of the following is true except. Next we have got sideropening dysphagia, which is also called as Plummer-Vincent or Plummer-Vincent and Patterson-Kelly syndrome. There is a well-known relationship between sideropenia. So sideropenia, by sideropenia it is meant that it is iron deficiency in absence of anemia. So you have got iron deficiency but anemia is absent. So there is relationship between sideropenia and development of oral cancer. Sideropenia is common in Scandinavian women, and that will lead to the epithelial atrophy, which renders the oral mucosa vulnerable to irritation from topical carcinogens. So all the carcinogens will act if patient is deficient in iron. So it is seen in Scandinavian people. So whenever you find the sideropenia, you have to correct with iron supplements. It will reduce the epithelial atrophy and the risk of malignant transformation will get reduced. Friends, now we will see various classifications of aerodigestive tract tumors. So oral cavity tumors and other mucosal lesions, they are classified. So this is identical for all mucosal sites of head and neck except nasopharynx. So we will see now various levels of lymph nodes. So we have got level, these are level, first is associated with submental and submandibular triangles. So level 2, 3, 4 nodes are associated with internal jugular vein within fibroid adipose tissue. This is posterior border of substernocleidomastoid and lateral border of sternohyoid. So level 1 is submental and submandibular triangle. So we have learned these all triangles in various neck swellings. So this is the same diagram. So we have got digastric muscle forming submandibular triangle. So level 1 lymph nodes are submental and submandibular, they are in this triangle. Then we have got level 2, 3, 4, they are associated with IGV along this region of the neck. So it is posterior border of sternocleidomastoid and lateral border of sternohyoid. So in between these two borders, we have got level 2, 3, 4 group of lymph nodes. So we have got level 2, that is upper third jugular chain, that is called a jugular digastric group of lymph nodes, and upper posterior cervical lymph node. So these are level 2. So these level 2 nodes have boundaries of hyoid bone as clinical marker and carotid bifurcation as surgical landmark. So whenever nodes we are finding around the hyoid bone, these are level 2 nodes, or around carotid bifurcation on surgical landmark as level 2 nodes. So this point should be marked. Level 3 are along middle jugular nodes. So below level 2 they are level 3. So these boundaries are inferior border of level 2 to cricothyroid notch. So this is clinical landmark. Or when you operate, if you find nodes along omohyoid muscle, these are level 3 lymph nodes. So lower jugular nodes are boundaries are inferior border of level 3 to clavicle. So lower than omohyoid muscle up to clavicle, these are lower jugular nodes, these are level 4. So level 2, 3 and 4 we have seen. Now level 5, this is posterior triangle. So whenever you have got lymph nodes in the posterior triangle of the neck, these are level 5 lymph nodes. These are posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle. So this is sternocleidomastoid muscle, you have got posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle, clavicle and anterior border of trapezius. So lymph nodes in this triangle are level 5. And level 6 lymph nodes, these are anterior compartment lymph nodes. So we have got this anterior compartment, the level 6 lymph nodes are in hyoid suprasternal notch and medial border of carotid sheath. So all lymph nodes which are medial to carotid sheath, these are level 6 lymph nodes. So squamous cell carcinoma in oral cavity and lips, they tend to metastasize to lymph nodes at level 1, 2 and 3. So this level 1, 2 and 3 have metastasis from oral cavity and lips. However, with squamous cell carcinoma of the tongue, there is risk of skip metastasis directly to lymph nodes to level 3 and level 4 without the involvement of higher level lymph node groups. So they can directly go to the level 3 and level 4. So this is very important point. So which of the following, or they may ask you question, skip metastasis is seen in which malignancy? So it is tongue. Tumors arising in oropharynx commonly metastasize to lymph nodes of level 2, 3, 4 as well as retropharyngeal and contralateral nodal group. So level 2, 3, 4 have metastasis from oropharynx. So friends, now we'll see what are TNM grades. So this is very important. So you should remember and memorize this classification very well, because many a times you are given a clinical scenario, a patient presenting to you with lesion of size 2 cm with lymph node on the same or opposite side of size say 4 cm. What will be the TNM staging? So what will be the nodal status? So all the permutation combinations I have been asked previously from this classification. So we have got TX, where primary tumor cannot be assessed. So when you are taken some biopsy, or when there is previous scarring and tumor cannot be examined properly, size cannot be assessed, so it is TX. T0 is no evidence of primary tumor. TIS is carcinoma in situ. T1 lesions are tumor less than 2 cm in greatest dimension. T2 lesions are tumor is more than 2 cm but less than 4 cm size. So T2 should be remembered. T3 lesions are tumor more than 4 cm but less than 6 cm. And T4 lesions are tumors which invade adjacent structures along with say, mandible and skin. So T4 lesions are invading adjacent structures like mandible and skin. So T4 lesions in various lesions are accordingly. So T4 of lip, so in T4 of lip you see primary tumor invading cortical bone, inferior alveolar nerve, floor of mouth or skin of face or nose or chin. So this is seen in T4 of lip. In T4 lesions of oral cavity, they are divided into T4A and T4B. So T4A will involve tumor invading adjacent structures such as cortical bone into deep tongue musculature or maxillary sinus or skin of the face. So these are called T4A for oral cavity. T4B for oral cavity is seen when tumor will be invading into masticator space, pterygoid blades or skull base, or it will encase internal carotid artery. So this is called as T4B lesion. So we have seen T stages of the tumor. Now we'll see regional lymph node status of the tumor. So NX is regional lymph nodes cannot be assessed. N0 is no regional lymph node metastasis is present. N1 is metastasis in single ipsilateral lymph node of less than 3 cm size in greatest dimension. So this is very important, because you may be asked a clinical question. So you have got node of size 2 cm. So it is N1 lesion. So ipsilateral on the same side of the tumor. So if you have got lateral border of tongue and the same side you have got node, that is then N1 lesion. Then we have got N2 lesion, which is divided into 2A, 2B and 2C. So metastasis in single ipsilateral lymph node of more than 3 cm size but less than 6 cm size is N2A. N2B lesion is metastasis in multilateral ipsilateral. So many nodes on the same side of size less than 6 cm is N2B. So you may have got multiple nodes, but they may be size 1 cm, 2 cm, but multiple. So on the same side they are N2B. N2C is metastasis in bilateral or contralateral lymph nodes none greater than 6 cm in greatest dimension. So if you got contralateral metastasis of size less than 6 cm is N2C. So this definition of various node size should be very much remembered. So many a times questions have been asked on this. N3 is metastasis in any lymph node of more than 6 cm size. So if you got single node of more than 6 cm size on the same side or opposite size, more than 6 cm is N3. So friends, just to make you aware that whenever you got less than 6 cm size, it is N2. So more than 6 cm is N3. So N2 you have to remember very much in detail. Amongst distance metastasis, we have got M0 as no evidence of distance metastasis and M1 as evidence of distance metastasis. So whenever you got lesion which is spreading other parts of the body, it is M1 lesion. Friends, now we'll see various regions of oral cavity. Now we'll see first carcinoma of the lip. So it is the most common site amongst carcinoma of the lip. It is a vermilion of lower lip. So it is this portion of the lip which is seen in most commonly. It is typically seen in male patients which are 40 to 70 years of age. There is definite correlation between lip cancer and exposure to sunlight. Non-healing ulcer or growth is the commonest presentation. It is locally malignant and lymph node metastasis develop late. So this is very important statement. So lymph nodes are seen late in case of carcinoma lip. The treatment options, the T1 and T2 lesions. So T1 lesions are tumor less than 2 cm size and T2 lesion is more than 2 but less than 4 cm size. So surgery is treatment of choice for T1 and T2 lesions. Surgery is done by V or W shaped full thickness excision with lateral margin of 5 mm of uninvolved lip, followed by primary closure if 1/3 of less than lip is involved. So you will be able to approximate when the lip margin involvement is less than 1/3. But whenever you have got more than 1/3 involvement in T1 and T2 lesions, you have to reconstruct with flap. So generally the flap reconstruction is done with Abbe or Islander's flap whenever more than 1/3 of the lip is involved. For tumor size T3 and T4, so tumor less more than 4 cm but less than 6 cm, it is T3, and T4 is tumor involving adjacent structures. So you have to give combination of radiotherapy and surgery or vermilionectomy or lip shaving for T3 and T4 lesion along with radiation. So radiation should be given for T3 and T4 lesions. So amongst all cancers of the oral cavity, carcinoma lip has got best prognosis amongst all oral cavity malignancies. So friends, we have seen various lesions of the oral cavity. So pre-malignant lesions, we have seen pre-malignant conditions. We have seen various levels of lymph nodes, level 1 to level 6. And we have seen various types of TNM classification, T1, T2, T3, T4. And N1, N2, N2 divided into N2, A, B, C and N3 lesions, and we have seen the features of carcinoma lip. Thank you.